Pianist in Barbara Thompson's quintet, which is a very straight-ahead band, and things like that. I even played with John McLaughlin for about 6 months before he became famous. He was just gigging around London. He had a duo, and I sometimes added him to my trio. So there's things like that. But by the early to mid-70s, I'd really got my focus together, and the music had developed anyway to become a lot freer. And ever since then, I've really, what's happened is my main focus has gone from trio playing to solo playing, really. Although I still do group things, but lately I've been concentrating on solo playing. So that's the chronology of it all. I'm trying to think if there's anything I've missed out. I mean, I don't think... service. And otherwise, I've lived in America a couple of times, once when I was a student at Indiana, then in the mid-70s. Now, musically, this is the interesting bit. This is where you've got to chip in, and it might correspond to your experience. I started off, my main interest to begin with was jazz, of course, and that's where I really focused myself. And I started off playing bebop, chord changes, to the music of the day. And that was simply because when I was still at school, I could work. I was playing, when I was still at school, I was playing in jazz clubs 3 nights a week. All right. I was still at school. But playing all the tunes of the day and everything. Then I would say probably when I came back from America in the mid-60s, from Indiana, that's when I started getting interested in freeing up the music. And that was very much a situation where in London at that time, that was in the air. There was, you know, there was a fantastic spirit around in London. And I mean, everybody played with everybody else. I mean, I wouldn't want to list them, but I played with a lot of people in that period, just casual one-off things. I mean, John was like that, John McLaughlin, really. Oh, yeah. He was a sort of, I only played with him a few times, but it was enough, you know, to strike a rapport. But I became interested in loosening up the music and making it a lot freer. And that then went through different phases, and I found that some periods in the time I was concentrating very much on things like the trio. There were periods when we concentrated on texture as opposed to line, and there were other times we concentrated on line as opposed to texture. We went through different developments, but the overall feeling of it was to try and come up with something not original, because I mean, my philosophy is that there's very few truly original players, but to try and come up with something that was your own individual statement. And the problem when I first started playing jazz, of course, back in the 50s and 60s, was that everybody in Europe were copying Americans. And of course, that was a loser's game, because you're never going to be as good as Coltrane doing that thing that they did. So that was the problem, how to find your way into something that wasn't totally original, but had your own individual imprint on it. Now that meant it was given various labels by critics. I mean, free jazz. I mean, there is a difference here. We can go into this if you want. Free jazz, improvised music. Well, what I mean, my interpretation of it is that free jazz started probably in America with people like Ornette Coleman. And I was aware of that in the late 50s. Of Ornette Coleman and Cecil Taylor, and I heard the records and I was interested, but I didn't really understand the conceptual basis of it. So I'd listened to that stuff and I thought it appealed to my ear and the feeling of freedom. I thought, I don't understand how they reached that point. I obviously wasn't mature enough to get there yet. But gradually, when I started playing, you know, tunes and everything, it became fairly obvious, and playing with people like Barry Guy on bass and the drummers I had, they were interested in pushing the music forward and freeing it up, really. And so eventually we reached a point where we said, well, what would happen if we didn't have tunes and we didn't have chord changes? And so we started playing with that and forming a different kind of vocabulary. Now, the label that's been put on that, I would say the early days, maybe mid to late 60s, most of the music that came up was free jazz, in inverted commas, if you want to put a label on it. After that, it becomes more confusing. Some of it was free jazz, some of it was improvised. Improvised music, by my definition, is something that obviously isn't influenced much by America, whereas free jazz was still very much influenced by American music, you know.
Yeah, blues and...
Yeah, that, and things like that. And it's also a feeling, the rhythm is the basis of it, the feeling of the rhythmic momentum, which sometimes is missing in the European thing, but that's got its own virtues, of course. So, I mean, the musicians I was playing with, we all of us took part in these different areas. We didn't just stay in one area. I mean, I'd be playing sometimes in a free jazz situation, trying to think of it. Well, I mean, if I think of records, that quartet with Trevor Watson, Barry Guy and John Stevens in the 70s, that was free jazz, basically. Whereas with improvised music, a record I did with Phil Baxman and Barry Guy called Improvisations Are Forever Now, that's improvised music, if you have to put labels on it. I'm not a big fan of labels, because I think they can be a bit misleading, but you know what I mean. But I mean, I've never been rigid about that, because basically my philosophy is I don't think there is one answer. I think there are many answers. I get a bit philosophical. We're going to veer into philosophy at various points in this. But I don't think there is one answer. And I think that what I've found is, in the last 10 years particularly, I've been in a situation, especially playing solo, where I've really tried to take all the best parts of the previous very concentrated developments and bring them together into my current style. And that's the way I'm working now. So when I play, I can do this playing solo, it's more difficult with a group. But if you're playing solo, you can put it in any direction you want. So often when I improvise, I use remnants of chord changes. Sometimes I play without chord changes. It just depends how I feel, what the audience is like, you know, and things like that. But I'm not into exclusively one style. I mean, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I think it all depends on the individual. But the approach I take playing solo wouldn't really be possible, or very rarely possible, in a group, because usually with groups they tend to focus on one particular thing, whether it be tunes and chord changes or free improvisation or whatever, to the exclusion of all else. I mean, like last night on the gig, that was very much in the free jazz, by my definition, jazz era. Very jazz music, there was a bit of both. But I mean, it was in very specific areas. Whereas with groups, that's usually the way it works. When you're playing solo, of course, you're free to use all your experience. But of course, it's a lot of work, is that? I mean, what it is, I think, is with most people who get playing jazz, and I mean, I would classify the music I play, I've always classified it as jazz, but it's not jazz in the, obviously, in the popular sense, and it's not going to make the top 20 or anything, but that's the background it comes out of, you know. And I still enjoy playing conventional jazz, but the problem with it is, you've got to find people to play with who have got a bit of adventure going and things, so who are prepared to stretch the envelope, as they say, because you know, you've got to have, it's an attitude of mind, really, lot of it. And especially in, I mean, we get into general discussion points here, but I mean, the society we live in tends to go for pre-packaged stuff. So it's very difficult to keep developing as an individual because you never know where it's going to take you. And that's the point of it. So you've always got to bear that in mind. You've got to be open to just letting it go where it wants to go, but at the same time keeping a critical approach to it, you know. It's a tricky thing. But as I say, my basic philosophy is I don't think one way of improvising is better than another. So I don't, you know, I don't say it. And it used to be, back in the 60s, things were a lot more polarised than the 70s. People used to say, oh, chord changes are finished, everything's free. Or the alternative, free's rubbish, chord changes are, you know, where it's at. They were very partisan then, and very polarised, and this is in the 60s and 70s. Now, I think there's a lot more, well, a lot more tolerance, I think, on all sides, you know. And people can take it where they want. But anyway, that's as far as I can think of it. My philosophy.
Thank you.